Well, hello, my name is Touria El Glaoui. I'm the founding director of 154, and I'm really pleased to present the inauguration of this year 154 forum, Continental Drift, curated by Dr. Omar Kholeif. As Omar has described it, this year's forum is composed as a symphony of sorts, a constellation of newly commissioned performance and poetry, anchored around salons where we will take a deep dive into some of the most urgent issues encompassing the artistic imagination of the African continent. This evening, Overture entitled The Continental Drift, Recuperating the Echoes, the Ghost, the Song, is a newly produced piece by Omar that explores the practice of translating identity through lyrics, music, and poetry. Halfway through this event, we are honored that Koyo Kouoh, the director of and chief curator of the Zeitz MOCAA, Cape Town, and founding director of Raw Material Dakar, will take over as a respondent and discussant. A conversation between two friends who journey in and out of each other's life. They have also noted that they enjoy in walking in each other's shoes, as Koyo was our beloved inaugural curator of the forum for many years and a dear friend of the 154 family. The talk will be followed by an incredible talk chaired by Princess Alia Al-Snoussi entitled The Virtual Salon, and the information on how to register is on the 154 website. I will now hand the floor over to Dr. Omar.
Thank you so much, Touria. And thank you, all of you, for being here. This is the overture to the Continental Drift. The ghosts, the songs, the echoes. Together we are standing or sitting apart on an open plain. Continental drift, a term used to induce the planetary, the modular, moving, interstitial fragility of an earth, its fragments, are here over the course of these 4 days, animated in commissioned poetry and song, new translation and interpretation, in simulated and free-flowing conversation. Composed as a modular opera intended to mutate in form as the realities of life itself over these days shifts, the drifting score here at 154 is a seed that is really about narration. The narration of convivial storytelling and the myriad forms that it takes in this moment in our lives and beyond. The overture is a convening of a sort. Shortly, I will convene with a ghost, perhaps, a splintered fragment from the self-published autobiography of Blake Kareem Mitchell, a person whom I have never met, but whose scant writing has sustained me, especially over the course of the last 2 years. The ongoing act of translation, I have found, of annotation and imagination, together have conjured a person who has become one of my most intimate collaborators. I sit here today in a modest attempt to walk in the shoes of an ally, a friend, a sister, whose words both directly and indirectly have been demonstrative of a particular kind of care, one that is situated in a camaraderie of kinship that extends beyond conceived borders, political belief, or the embodied features of practiced faith, or the expressions of pigment in the human flesh. For one, she is of the few, so, colleagues to ever utter the words, congratulations to me. Koyo Kouoh, director and chief curator of Zeitz MOCAA in Cape Town and the founding director of Raw Material in Dakar, instigator of so much more through the effective relationships that she holds with friends, artists across the world, will take over the second half of the score. I have invited her to press back in whichever way that she chooses, to the project at hand. The author of the following text goes by the name of Blake Kareem Mitchell. As far as I am aware, they have produced one book, an autobiography in lyrical form, which may or may not be fictionalized, or at least the subject of hyperbole. The material was unspooled from a pile of materials laden with dust, debris I encountered the last time that I visited Cairo. To my eyes, it appears to be self-published. The context of why I took to this text is perhaps best left as a matter for a different time, or rather the context will make itself evident in the reading to follow. The issue that I became invested in when I started to strain to resuscitate my mother tongue of Arabic, the language that I was using to translate this text to the English, was the manner in which interpreters transfer power. I suppose that is what was revealed, is that much like colonizers, they have the agency to narrate, indeed reorientate even one's own personal memories. My choice of adjectives, the perception of gender or pronoun, and even the excerpts that I have chosen to share with you today can all, with a mere slip of two letters, tip the meaning of this person's life into a wholly different direction. Next time I present Blake's work to you, I may remember it differently, much like muscle memory, emotional memory, the encoding of perception, the ontology of the self rotates across and through an axis. Can we only see ourselves? Ever see ourselves? Do we merely transfer ourselves through acts of interpretation? Or does the act of translation in and of itself change us? I invite you all to take breath. Act one of Infinity. Her versus her. Jiddo called her Dollface. Right off the Orient Express. A mezzo soprano of a couple of octaves and those semitones. Kulthum's nationalist songs contrarily elicited vehement murmurs from the old geezer. Muslim sons don't ask questions of their fathers. the words an echo from my Baba? Or was it all part and parcel of Mama's psychobabble? When I began to pay the bills, I perceived that things would change in the domestic sphere. But Jiddo broke into tremors every time Kalsum's contralto humbly entered the room, ascending to beckon, summon, and command. The spindly dark man entered the room with hands covering up his droopy dog ears. Shadya, 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 he smiled. But Kalthum has her pearls in the Louvre, I bellowed. Elongated fingers, uncut Cruella nails prick my cheek. A grimy spindle, a drop of blood. The lyrics to Shadya's "Ah, Ya Asmarani Loon" might give something away. Oh, you of the tanned complexion, she exclaims. Oh, you of the tanned color. My love, O tanned one, my eyes have forgotten me. She walks the lengths of countries, she purports, for this tanned body, wanting a taste of his thorny flower over any other provision. Not even water. I was raised to believe this was a song that bonded the country. Mama, a musicologist, had once noted it to be a tale of solidarity. Peace, love, and harmony among the colors of Afrika. When I fast forward to the future, to the land of fake bake, industries born around skin whitening, I wish that I had disputed Jiddu and Mama, called them out with the angst of a million trillion cats on heat. Jiddu isn't a tan, merely but a temporary thing. Would a Nubian god such as yourself, such as Amun, bleach their skin? Or was there something else, my beloved elder, terrifying you? A contralto or a countertenor? A man, not a boy, singing not only in your ears, but in your very home. Act 5 of An Unceasing Tale. Black is the color of my true love's hair. Annotation note, we are starting somewhere not at the start or even the middle. We pass by some anomalous text. I sat lodged in my head, the image of the shit-stained sheets, the piss-soaked streets. Aspiration became a taunting bully, a bulimic aggressor. An executor of care was something I was not to be. Brain fog had become constant, my screws looser than his. Unclogging the feces from the gutter, a pipe snapped. It gushed out, "Good morning, you have found the light." Text double indentation, print error or intention, null ambiguity, ? I came here for the silence. I try to remind myself as I squat in a metal basin, constipated once again, the primary constituents of my diet being pap and chicken grease. Venda was a former black homeland. Never independent, not truly, its spirit laden, its oxygen hollowed from the sickle cell. My job as a clerk in Toyandu, annotating the forlorn lives of victims of white rape, was considered a noble use of my legal study. These elongated sessions rapidly became quotidian, until one day, a woman stretched out her hand to touch my cheek. Makua, she yelled. Or was it a hushed whisper? A question or an exaltation? I had not realized my whiteness till that moment. Annotation, translator is jumping ahead. I take long weekends in Jacaranda City, the shared bathrooms of the youth hostel, stocked with scented lavender soap, the smells and textures of this place, embossed sediments, a palimpsest. Drinking a bottle of imported beer in the ramshackle they called a bar, stood a hunched body in all black, cap and all, his butt squinting at me. The boy as white as snow, as he would come to be known. He had arrived here after traversing borders of Namibia and Zimbabwe, apparently. A Makua alone, hiding amidst the black threads. His mid-Atlantic pricked my ears. His face a cartoonish mishmash of contours, but for a pair of glistening blue eyes that fizzed like the beer at the tip of his bottle. The Blue Nile was for the dark-skinned, or so we were raised to believe. The boy as white as snow could stretch time. That holiday weekend speedily became love. He rinsed my back in the communal shower, rubbing soap into the swollen sockets I could not reach. I loved him most when he did not ask questions. I think he much preferred it that way. He spoke of his family, the women in his life, Scottish ancestry, a woman who taught him to sing. Was he a light lyric tenor or a fond alto, a baritone, a countertenor? He explained that to be the same as a female contralto, the rarest, the purest of voices. He did not leave me anything, not even his hat, not an object to smell, not a memento to touch. All I hold is the sound of his voice. Buzzing, resonant, buried in my ears. Black is the color.
Black is the color of my true love's hair. His face, so soft and wondrous fair. Ground or where he stands. I love the ground of where he stands. Oh, black.
Act infinitum, endless endlessness. I hate writing after sunset. All hope is hollowed out of my vocabulary by then. I had no choice. The lake summoned me. Swimming is the only thing that my family insisted that I had to learn. FOBs don't sink. The locals still ask that question, why did you come here? The quiet, I retort. I do the books here, making neoliberalism keep looking good. The gift of an economics degree, a bit of vitiligo, the white power of the Ottoman Empire, porous skin. These middle lower plains in the West give me a new name. They let me choose it. Blake, an old English name. Perfect. Paradox. Pale, blonde one, it means. Or quite simply, black. Mitchell, in Hebrew, equaled who looks like or in the image of God. How about that, Jiddu? The ashen skin of my grandfather, Jiddu Jiddu, creeps into the folds of my memory. His pride, oh, his pride, for I was an exemplar of the successes of intermarrying, which he so meticulously coordinated. An erasure, a removal, an obliteration, a rose awaiting me on the other side. 8 years have passed since I visited the hostel in Pretoria. I would see his face hidden behind sawdust, creeping, crawling, slivering, me inside of him, he inside of me, living castrati, ornament and blemish, imbibing each other, his skin, not mine. Or was it my skin, not his? His skin, not mine. I ask for a moment.
Sylvan trees bearing strange fruit, blood on the leaves and blood at the roots. Sylvan trees, black bodies swinging in the southern breeze. Blood on the leaves, strange fruit and blood at on the blue
Everybody's swinging in the seven trees.
Here is a road for the rain to gather.
Thank you. Elegance. Thank you very much. That's me.
Thank you. Wow. Oh. Thank you very much for this intense moment of poetry. I don't even know where to start, because how do you respond to poetry? You don't respond to poetry. You enjoy poetry, you take poetry in, you let it sink into your mind and body, and you let it do the magic that poetry does. So, I am truly somewhat over-asked, so to speak, as a respondent to your amazing poetry. What I think, however, I want to share, and what touched me so much in your multi-layered text and its non-linearity, we, to a certain extent, also represent a kind of a search. And that confirms also the non-linearity of life. There is no straight line to anything. There is a constant up and down and winding and, you know, and searching and pull and push and, so I, and this link sends me to the search for self, actually. Who am I? Who are you? Where do I come from? What is, why am I here for? And your text seemed to me as a love letter to someone, I think, you didn't know very well, but who is an integral part of who you are, an integral part of what you sort of believe and consider yourself to be. And the complexity of that, or the difficulty of that, is exactly to really have no memory or no experience and have to recreate it in a way that is not necessarily the way that your family or where you come from, or your community or the setting that you come from expect of you. So using poetry and art, just because life itself is not enough. And just because the stories that we've heard from our ancestors, of our parents and grandparents, are not enough. So we have to sort of push the imagination to a space that allows for recreation. Recreation in a sense of recreating in a plastic way, but as well also as recreating in an imaginative way of an imaginary self. The text also made you think, you were speaking about modular identity. And I think that the continent is a perpetual kind of well of this modularity that takes many forms. Migratory form, it takes the imaginative form, it takes the narrative form, but it also takes the fixed form, fixed by our unreal borders. So when you speak of the Blue Nile, for instance, the Blue Nile, that is the land of the dark skin, so to speak, in the context of Egypt, and the whole reality and process of erasure of, you know, the tan, if I may use your term, that also is a space where the conversation of who's African and who's not becomes extremely interesting to me in ways that summons a certain, how can I put it? In French, you would say effronterie, but a certain kind of boldness and radicalness by means of at least intellectually and mentally deactivating what separates, so to speak, and deactivating the borders, and really get into a sense of fluidity or a space of fluidity that that allows to grasp or to at least name and put a finger on the multiplicities of the self that we carry, each and every one of us in ourselves, but also this place in the larger context of community, of society, of country, of continent, so to speak. So I think that it's a continuous kind of, I wouldn't call it effort, but it's a continuous work and activity that many of us who identify as Africans and who identify with the richness of that territory and who identify with the complexities of that territory and who reject the divisions that were established and who are working so hard to get to a place where the limitations of the past become actually, how can I put it? I'm really looking for the right word, where the limitations of the past basically become assets, so to speak. Assets of the recreation that I was speaking earlier, I was speaking about earlier. So, and also where it also lends me to where the personal, we shy away so much of putting ourselves forward, so to speak, regardless of the, you know, the flurry of platforms and the tools that we have today. And it's when I say putting ourselves forward, putting the personal forward, we have learned to dismiss the personal as non-professional, as non-political, as not significant, as not public, whereas the personal is public, the personal is political, the personal is significant. I have had to learn it for over the past 5 years myself. You know, where do you want to begin if you don't begin with yourself? in many ways.
May I respond to that?
Please.
I mean, I wanted to first begin by saying thank you and that I, for this response, but also that I did over ask as a respondent from you, because in a sense, these ideas or formulations emerged from you, in particular because of your very specific caring curatorial practice, where it is about a kind of, I'm not even yet going into the issue of border and territory or nation state or anything, but just whoever and whomever you work with, the concept of care has been fundamental. And the other day we discussed how this has been a vogue now in, you know, the world of art, how we should all care. But this is something that the first time I met you, you had feedback from me. You had observed something of me. You gave something to me, but you also invited me to consider my identity the first time you met me. And for me, this has been the most challenging thing, because identity, it's not that it's just fluid, it is barbed in prison type encasings that a certain hegemony needs to use against certain people. So it's not simply that even if we are more fluid than we ever were, that we can indeed claim the identity that we believe we are, because then it becomes, we see things like ourselves being made a mockery out of, you know, in the public arena, from Rachel Dolezal to families in Ohio claiming blackness because of their love of hip hop culture, which makes more mainstream news than the work of much more interesting thinking. And but today I was kind of troubled right before this, 15 minutes before, that, you know, Abdelrazak won the Nobel Prize for literature. And I get a text saying, and so I check his biography, because I have to be frank, I'm not particularly affine to this person's literature, although I read an incredible amount. But still, he's identifies as Tanzanian, and born in the Sultanate of Zanzibar. But a family member or name who says, an Arab won the Nobel for literature today, and you should be proud. And because, you know, and I don't even choose to dig in that, but that segmentation of self, that notion that you don't know where you're from until you're an adult, because no one wants you to know, because it might hurt you, is why I became interested in pursuing the text, which is to look at the text and to understand what is in it, how I can decode it, and how I can bring it back to the emotional and the personal. And that is why I believe that what you said at the end is so critical. If people could just play that on loop, that if you cannot start with the self, how do you look? From where do you look? Why do you even bother? And that's, I think, a fight in the realm of culture that we are facing, because of this notion of a heightened professionalization, which is exhausting, to the point that I no longer really, and I know one should not say such things so definitively, but I really feel uncomfortable calling myself a curator, because I love the notion of caring, but I'm not the greatest carer. I need to be cared for too. And quite frankly, I work with living artists primarily, so I don't want to embody that name. And I don't want that to mean I'm thinking about boxes, you know? I perceive what I do, making exhibitions, working with artists, poets, thinkers, scientists, as really an artist of delegation, who, you know, delegating ideas through other minds and bodies and receiving them back. And I think that's become magical. Think that way.
Yeah,
I don't know what
I really think that maybe I'd like to underline here, when I talk about the self and the personal, and how that is public and political and significant, I certainly don't mean this kind of a self-indulgent, self-referentiality that absolutely has no form of value whatsoever for society, in a sense. But I'm really talking about that personal, that self, where you see, you live, you identify, you know, parallels of what is happens in your life, or what you're exposed to historically, politically, emotionally, culturally, that has significant and value for a larger conversation for society. So I think it's very important to make that distinction, because we are flooded with useless self-referentiality on a daily basis, and this is not what I think. And I think that this is not what I mean. And I think that history, sort of, we relate to history, or some of us at least, relate to history in a way that it's particularly from, you know, an African perspective, in a way that is, for me personally, visceral to you know, the definition of self and the searching of self, you know, which is a constant kind of process as we journey through life in many ways. And this is why I really like this this notion of art as an extension of life, poetry as an extension of life, and in the context of the continent, particularly, how we have grown and learned to internalize those divisions, and have been. I mean, it's very lovely that you reminiscent our first meeting, because as many people know, I've been an advocate for, you know, speaking of the continent in its globality and in its entirety, as opposed to its divisions. And I think that there are valid, absolute valid critique about this perspective. However, I strongly believe that, and now, for instance, in my new position at Zeitz MOCAA, where our curatorial purview even extends the continent to include the diaspora as an additional space, or as an expanded space of thinking about Africa, and I wouldn't say blackness, because I think we didn't even really have time to delve into that. But what I want to say is that when we met, and of course I met you before we met physically, I've been studying you, I've been looking at you, I've been reading you, and I always feel like we are not that many out there, and we need more. We need to build armies. We need to build real arsenals of people and minds, because there is so much work to do. And when I think from and for me, it becomes like an urgency that every single one of us, from Tunis to Cape Town, from Djibouti to Dakar, from Cairo to Douala, from Maputo to Agadez, you know, has to, or should, let me be milder, should take position and come to the front. Yeah. And the front being, you know, the war zone, so to speak, because it's a war. It's a war of meanings. It's a war of definitions, if you want. It's a war of representation. It's a war of occupation, if I may use that. So seeing a gifted person like you not taking that position back then, I felt a responsibility to say, hello, Omar, there is something larger going on here. You know, that's exactly what I meant.
I mean, but you cut through to a very personal thing, which is why the personal is, I mean, I think also a lot of the self-reflexive stuff that you're discussing also is like a remnant of post-modernity. And I think when post-modernity ended, everyone just went back to modernity and went back to even more antiquated practices in some regards. But, you know, the thing was that you triggered a process of discovery and questioning and looking at archives of myself, because who is told to ever consider themselves? Because no one is important in capitalist society. You are just parts of a machine. And I learned things about the whitening of families being just a normal practice. The erasure of half of my so-called nationalistic or ethnic identity, because I mean, Egypt and Sudan were one country, but there is, and I'm from both, but there is no Sudan ever mentioned in my life ever. And it isn't until I start to ask the questions, well, sorry, if my grandfather is a Black man born in Khartoum, doesn't that make him Sudanese, or why doesn't make him not? And those simple questions, some people never ask, because that's just the reality of things, in the same way that you can live on the continent and not travel it, which is something that was very important for me, is that, first of all, we must admit to our privileges that a lot of people with passports, the borders are not, and I mean, if they're by land, it's different, but you cannot enter every African continent, the same way that South Asia, you cannot. I hate that they call South Asia, the Asian subcontinent, South Asia, because Bangladeshis and Pakistanis and Indians cannot roam between these countries with their passports. But we have now to have the privilege of a passport that gives me access. The first thing that I did was to live on the continent, because I had never lived on it. And it was there that I learned to never use words like sub-Saharan Africa when I lived in South Africa. And in Zimbabwe and in Mozambique, and then I was in Namibia. I don't use those words, or North Africa or West Africa, because it's like we're self creating silos of the self. When another thing that I wanted to just mention is that this text is the very beginning of something of, really, it is about translating the ideas of many, not just one, but the identities of many. But the truth of this matter is that we exist in a very kind of interstitial space where the narrative, the document, has not been offered by us. At least so much as if you want to get the accreditation to move into a specific sphere, you are expected to understand the other document. And what I'm looking for personally is a proliferation of poetry, literature, that it comes from the lived experience, because we need to deconstruct these myths, like the Blue Nile, that are handed down, that many of which are remnants of colonialism, and not simply sit back and say, oh, but we all, you know, we were colonized and we're left to F. No, because if you write, if you make art that speaks and takes a position, then you change something. I know it's small, but you change your way of thinking. And we have to think of this earth as not just us, but also everyone else. And that's the biggest problem. I cannot believe that for so many people, Africa is a metaphor. It troubles me.
Well, don't waste your energy and your and your emotions on that. I think I really believe that these deconstructions, I mean, you mentioned earlier that Gona, the freshly Nobel Prize, Literature Nobel Prize winner, was identified as Arab. And I think that one of the conversations that I've been having since many years is to even deconstruct the very idea of an Arab world, you know, which from my African perspective, if you just look at the map of what is considered Arab world, you see that half of it is on the African continent. So, and if you look at it's part and parcel. And you mentioned also, I have to say, your aversion to the kind of divisionist term of sub-Saharan. I mean, there are other people who defend it in a way that is plausible to them in many ways. It's part and parcel of a process and a program of dispossession, I think. And I consider it my duty as a cultural worker, as a person who provides spaces of freedom and who provides spaces of, you know, deconstruction and investigation and imagination, I consider it as really my duty to absolutely offer another alternative or other alternatives. And for me, it becomes really like, how can I put it, a form of a combat, so to speak, because there are so many forces opposing that unity, be it even, you know, imaginary, but Pan-Africanism was fed by that imaginary of unity. And I think that regardless of how much the political ambition or the political idea so-called failed, its potency in galvanizing and in supporting, let me call it writing of ourselves, is part and parcel of this quest for, you know, a sense of unity. The fluidity I referred to before, have been our part, I mean, our part of all territories, you know. So the borders and the boundaries that people set to themselves or that geopolitics and history build are unfortunately still very much active on the continent. And I think that the space that we inhabit, we people of arts and culture, we cultural workers, are exactly that space of possibilities, that space of propositions. And that is a space that is utterly important. And I think that it is, what can I say? The writing has to continue, the deconstruction has to continue, the search has to continue. And I don't necessarily believe that we will arrive at the place in our lifetime, and not even in the lifetime of our descendants, in a place where those issues might be solved, because I'm not convinced that they can be solved in a satisfactory manner, because I think as I mentioned earlier, there is no linearity. We go two steps ahead and we go three steps back, and then we jump a big leap forward, and then we go sideways, and then we go tangential. And this is what life is about, and this is what constructions of societies are about. However, I strongly believe that when you look at it from an African perspective, there is a stigma that we all share. Be you consider yourself west, east, sub, up, whatever, there is a stigma, and we have to work against that stigma. And I think that we should not fool ourselves, particularly, certainly not fool ourselves with the idea that, you know, there is a kind of, how can I put it, growing interest now. But we shouldn't, that's not our conversation. No, our conversation is about self. It's about you and me and Turia and everybody else, you know. What are we doing? How can we really participate in enlarging the book, our book, and enlarging and deepening our chapters? And it's not about, personally for me, it's not about, you know, the valorization of whatever, you know. Sometimes you read all sorts of stupid things attached to you, and things that you don't even think and that you never said, but it's really just about, we are part of the world, and we inhabit that world. We inhabit those ideas, and they are simultaneous. They are parallel. They are concomitant. They are, you know, it's for me not a separate kind of place. Even though, of course, and I like to contradict myself in that, on that point, is that even though I certainly believe that we have, as Africans, at least those who are, I would say, brave enough to identify as such, and not try to, you know, specify a particular region or a particular background, we have this responsibility to to reject any limitations, and to really, I have to say that I'm a bit jumping from the monkey to the giraffe, as I say sometimes. I have to say that there is so much more need to speak to ourselves, yeah, than to speak to anyone else, basically.
Yeah.
And I think this is what I've been trying to do. I've tried to do over the past 25 years, and which is what I'm also continuing to do. We need our own stories.
Yeah. We need, the interesting thing is that there are books that say things like, we need more stories. And I say no, because we are not an addendum to a narrative hegemony. We just need stories that are ours, that are not, that don't have to interrelate to those. They don't have to be about colonial enslavement of the imagination or any of those things. I just want to experience the multitude of experiences that we can experience. And we're short on time, but I wanted to just say that I would like to invite you to continue the conversation another time in order to think about some of these ideas around what are the questions that we will ask ourselves, and how will we manifest that knowledge? And is it in practice? Is it in writing? Is it simply in taking the time to care for oneself, the rest? Or, like, fundamental tenets that I've seen you kind of enshrine actually a lot in through the mutual friendship that we have with the artist Otto Bong Nkanga, who's a big part of this forum, a big part of my life, and one of, you know, a very dear soul, but a dear collaborator to us both, is that I've learned also through, let's call them mediator best friends, about skill, different skill sets from you. And I thank you, and I treasure that you took this time to think with me, respond, and layer the context. It's really incredibly generous, but also I really hope that you will let me invite you to continue this further. We have so much more to do, as you say.
Absolutely. With pleasure, anytime for you. You know how much I love you and how much I cherish your mind and how much I'm enthralled by your poetry and ideas. So the work is on.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
And thank you to everyone who's listened. And we will see you soon. If anyone wants, 7 p.m., a killer virtual salon for all of you. Sayonara.